It's like having glasses on your forehead. So how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. Are you exhausted by your output, or is it a little less intense than those of us who experienced it all within the same week?
I'm not exhausted. It's a long run, so you want to sort of protect your energy and take it easy and try to sleep well, which is the key.
Were you working on both films at the same time?
Yeah. Yeah, kind of, yeah.
How did that happen? Or was that just...
It was a happy accident. I did a movie called The Club, and that movie went to Berlin Film Festival, where Darren Aronofsky was the head of the jury. And then, well, we got an award from them, and then in the after party, I met him, met Darren, and he invited me to make Jackie. And I was about to go into production with Neruda, and somehow we decided to just make both movies back to back, and here we are. So yeah.
So you didn't think you were completely insane to try that, or?
Well, at some point, yeah. But it's I guess you can, at least I can work in different things as long they're not together when you're shooting. I think that's where you really need to focus on what you're doing, and the rest of the time where you're prepping or in post or doing press or whatever, you can probably do more than one, I guess. It's possible, yeah. But not when you're shooting. I think when you're shooting, it's just where you really are.
You don't want to have more than one thing going at the same time.
No, it's just, no, I guess it's enough, yeah.
So are you, you're so far what we've experienced of you, in the United States at least, almost everything is connected to history in some way.
It's true, yeah. I've done 7 movies and 5 of them are period movies. So it's, yeah, I don't know why, but I keep coming back. Yeah.
Were you always interested in history? Are you a buff of the past?
I am very interested. I think we have something that's going on today in the world that it feels like people is just like standing and looking at their feet and that everything that actually exists is just present and maybe future, but we have a background. We've been we've been around for billions of years in this planet, and we have built whatever we are, for good or bad, a ton of things, and those things have a meaning and they have a reason, and they have shaped who we are, and I think there's a lot of human beauty and in the past, and you can really, really understand where we are and who we are. I like to think something that I saw in the White House tour while doing Jackie, and that President Kennedy said, that he said that the past was the prologue of the present, which I think is interesting. And there's always a prologue, and there's always things that have shaped us, and I don't know, and I don't intend to, when I work in period movies, I don't intend to feel or to believe that we're actually in that period of time. I assume that we have the advantage of time, that we are here, that we are in 2016, so that we know what happened afterwards. We don't know what's going to happen next, but we do know what happens in between those days and now.
Right.
So we try to sort of assume that information and look at those events from the eyes of today and try to digest that information with what we see and what we have around us now.
Do you see it as metaphor for current events or things like that, or do you think about that? Or
I don't, but metaphors can, and they can by themselves. I like to think about paradox, contradictions, repetitions. I think we're repeating, ourselves as humanity all the time, and we just, and that's very interesting. But I do believe there's something that you will never really understand how those events happened, or some of them, and So there's a gap, and mm-hmm. there's like a black hole somehow. And even though you could be, you know, very well informed and educated about the events that you're dealing with, mm-hmm. there's a lot of things that you would never know how that happened. And those are the doors for fiction, and that's where we get in, and that's how we work. And it's incredible to have the opportunity to just, like, I don't know, like, make a little hole in that wall and get into with a camera and think about how they thought, how they felt, and how was that, but always with the tool of fiction, which is arbitrarity, you know, and creativity combined. And yeah, and you could usually find elements that just would define who we are now, and those elements are always connected with the three cores, I would say, that cinema needs, which is love, rage, and curiosity.
Love, outrage, and curiosity?
Love, rage.
Just rage, okay.
And no curiosity, way. Yeah.
So what rage did you bring to Neruda?
Well, there's a lot of rage in there, I think. Neruda was a man who had an incredible amount of dreams, and he was using his work, his art, his poetry to protect those dreams. And those ideals were shaped in a modernistic world, so they're pretty hard to understand the same way that they were thought back then, today. But if you look at them, you would see the lack of equality. It's a problem that we still have. The lack of respect for minorities is a problem that we still have, and the use of art as a tool for human development, and it's also something that is still very active, and I think those ideals were in Neruda's mind, and besides, he was an incredible and wonderful poet, and it was always, you know, challenging and interesting and beautiful to dig into his work.
So the layers of Neruda in the film, did you spend a lot of time layering in? It feels like there's, you know, the film in some ways is more of a poem, or has a poem element to it.
Yeah.
Combined with the story.
Yeah. We like to think that Neruda is a movie that we made for him, you know, that we have at some point dreamt that he would see this movie somehow. And yeah, more than a movie about Neruda, what we like to think is a movie about what we say in Spanish, lo nerudiano, the Nerudian world, his cosmos, what he created. That it's not just himself, basically, because it's not possible to bring him into a film. It's ungrabbable. It's just so wide and extensive and mysterious that you can't put it in a film. But then you could sort of dig and try to sort of feel who he was, and we like to think that this movie is a little bit like going into his house and playing with his toys, you know, and somehow we started with a more conventional biopic idea, and then slowly our writer Guillermo Calderon, who did incredible, wonderful work, he discovered that we could use the cap as a point of view. Mm-hmm. And that's where the doors were open to us, and we were able to sort of play with this fiction idea over the fiction. If you see, there's something that is very interesting. Neruda, when he got the Nobel Prize in early 70s, he read a very beautiful speech, and he referred to these years where he was escaping, which is where the movie tells. And he is very extensively, you know, explained on the speech, and it's very beautiful. You could look at it, it's online. And at some point he says that he doesn't know that he wrote this, he lived it, or he dreamt it. And once we got there, like, we said, okay, he opens the doors for us, and we sort of create this fiction around these true events. So there's a lot of stuff that's actually happened, but it's like on the record. But there are a lot of stuff, probably more than the ones that are real, that we fictionized, and we were inspired by his job, by his poem, by his rhythm, by his life, by his love for food, for women, for literature, for crime novels, for traveling. He was an incredible collector, a diplomat, a politician. He was a man who could have been the president of my country, you know. So it's someone who had such a wonderful cosmos that it's always interesting to to work with those materials. And I'm sure there's a lot more movies to come out of his work and life.
Well, it's funny because it seems so different than Jackie in certain ways. It seems like a different... Jackie seems more, I don't know, more tightly structured, more kind of a... It doesn't have that rollicking feel of the traveling or being chased or any of that stuff. But yet, in some ways, they're very similar in that regard. In well, that you're kind of doing... You're bouncing off of the ideas of Jackie as much as you're literally telling a story.
Yeah, well, they're both icons from the 20th century. And it's funny because, you know, we all know that those days in the White House in early 60s was the middle of the Cold War, and they were struggling to defeat communism in the world. And Neruda, he was the head of the Communist Party in my country and probably the most important communist in the world back then. So they are in different sides, but they both somehow share a similar spirit, and I like to think about that, and I keep having this imaginary conversation in between Jackie and Neruda. I never know if it ever happened. We have no records. I keep digging into it to see if they actually met, but they do have something in common, that they were both somehow working on their own legends and with less or more conscious about it, they were doing it. And it's interesting because there's always a gap in between the intention and the result, you know, what people actually believe or think about them. And that gap is where the fiction is, and that's the gap where we could get into it and work, because it's an unknown and undeterminated place. And Jack is more, I guess, like a study of a personality and a sensibility and the story of a woman who became, you know, the only queen, the queen without a throne, you know, without a husband, without a king that this country ever had.
So is getting her right in that regard really important to you? I mean, how much, when you see Jackie, how much, it's a wonderful performance and everything is great about it. It's a beautiful movie. But is that, are we to believe that that is who Jackie Kennedy was? Or is this an idea of Jackie Kennedy?
I don't think so. I would say that it's more an approach to a specific sensibility. That's what we try to capture. More than going out to the world and telling people, look, this is Jackie Kennedy, and if you want to know who she was, come and watch this film. Mm-hmm. I would like to think that, I mean, you could do that, but we were after to trying to understand what that woman went through and how she was able to shape and sort of support a country's identity throughout an incredible amount of grief and pain, and how she was like working on protect JFK's legacy, and by doing it, she made him a legend, and by doing that, she became an icon, you know, and ultimately almost a mannequin, you know, and so that process, that sort of a study on grief, that that woman who was immediately after the assassination was protected by a lot of people. It was a woman that ended up protecting everybody else. So she was like the one that opened this huge umbrella, and everybody would sort of stick to her and feel protected by her. So I think it's very interesting because it's very connected with what's going on today in this country. I think it's... And we're not talking about girl power or anything like that. We're talking about the role of women today in contemporary politics. I'm thinking on, of course, Michelle Obama. I'm thinking on Hillary Clinton. And I'm thinking on how those women were or are redefining, you know, and reshaping the role of the woman. You know, there's a saying that I'm sure it's the same in English, but in Spanish, you say, behind every man, there's a great woman.
There's a great woman, yeah.
Yeah. How do you say it?
Behind every great man, there's a great woman.
Behind every great man, there's a great woman. I would say behind every great person, there's a great mother. Mm-hmm. So that's, I guess, the point of view of this. And yeah, so it's like there's a sensibility that this world needs, and it's a strength and a power and a specific approach to things that are, I think, they're very necessary. And we need it, and it's not. I'm not talking about equality, right. and I'm talking about a human necessity to have those women.
What's interesting that it also times out. It's in certain ways about privacy and about being able to shape things, the way she wants to shape things, which we're finding out as we go through this election, particularly with the emails coming out and WikiLeaks all over the place. That idea of creating an image is almost impossible now. Even though the tools are still there, it's now being the many tools that are coming now to destroy those images.
But I mean, probably because of the media today, the circumstances are different. But I guess the problem is always the same. Mm. There's always an intention, an idea of somebody's image, and then it's always what the people really think about it. And the media has changed. We have today emails or Twitter or the social networks and stuff like that. But we do have the same circumstances. Like back then there was newspaper, and before it was TV, and before it was like books, and before it was like, I don't know, just people talking on bars or whatever. But there's always a gap and an undeterminated place. And that's why, I don't know, we're a week away or 10 days away from the election, and it's not completely sure who's going to win. And that's democracy. That's what people would choose. And you don't know how's that going to end up. And nobody knows how people would think about these contemporary leaders in 20 years or in 100 years. And that is interesting, because I think history can be harsh sometimes, but at the same time, I do believe that history can be very balanced and could put people in the proper place, and on time. And that's interesting. And if you look back at like icons of the 20th century, we know who did it right and who did it wrong. And we know who we respect and who we don't. And we know we don't respect people like, I don't know, Hitler or Pinochet or those guys, but we do respect Martin Luther King and we do respect, I don't know, like a ton of people that are shaped and make this world better and interesting. But there's something there in media, and that's why I think Jackie's also, and Neruda, it's also a movie about media, about how do you relate to media and use media to shape your own image. But you just can't control it. Mm. And that's interesting. Because if somebody could actually control it, then why would they need us? We will be just puppets, and we're not. We have voice and we have will, and we can vote and decide, and we have an opinion. We can share opinions in multiple places, and that's interesting.
So it seems kind of like Jackie may have been the last third person in a position, particularly, to control image that way and to create that iconography the way she did. I mean, there was the circumstances of it helped as well, unfortunately. You know, the death of the president changed the dynamic, but it's interesting, like, it seems like that could not happen now. She could not have built that fortress around herself.
So. You never know. Yeah. You never know. She was, when she became first lady, she made this huge restoration in the White House, right? So she was very criticized, because she was spending a lot of money and people thought it was like a public money, and then she was just doing stuff by her after her own taste. Mm-hmm. So President Kennedy went to her and said, why don't you do this TV show and do the White House tour and tell people what's the reality, which is that they raised the money privately, and then they were like, the restoration, most of it was basically bringing old furniture and all kind of things that were at some point in the White House, mm-hmm. that had historical value, back to the White House, which make that house even more interesting, because they had mm-hmm. the chance to have all these old objects that has historical meaning. And by doing it, and she was like walking around the White House, talking to the American people, how was the White House on the inside, showing every detail with a lot of knowledge and education in a very sort of beautiful, mysterious way. But she also refers a lot and extensively about Lincoln's assassination and about Lincoln's widow and how she died destitute, and she had to prone all the civil war, and she had problems to maintain herself and the children afterwards. And it's incredible because like it feels like it's like a foreshadow of Jackie, and she was like sort of creating this strange sort of prediction of herself, this kind of map of pain, by talking about somebody else's story. And then 2 years after, it's exactly what happens to her. Mm-hmm. So it's very, I think, undeterminated whatever is going to happen to any of us, and especially in public figures, it's just everything is just so out of control in a way that makes this world so interesting, because it's just changing and rechanging. And that's why I think it's so beautiful to go back to those days and to work over histories and historical subjects, because those are the elements to let you understand where we're coming from. Mm-hmm. And at least you have a feeling and a proximity to those days, even if it's a description of something that was like very sad and terrible, like what Jackie Kennedy experienced, or something so playful and interesting and funny and sort of political as Neruda experience. So I think I'm very glad to have the chance to deal with such a different people, but you know, they're connected, I think.
So when Darren came to you with this idea, with this project, was it a script at that point? Was it?
Yeah, there was a script, a wonderful script by Noah Oppenheim, and I read it, and I did a few suggestions that we worked over the time with Noah. And Darren was always very, very generous to me and everybody and his company. But I said that I would only do this movie with Natalie. And I'm sure there's a lot of actresses could do a great, great job. But I don't think anybody could do it as beautiful and deep as Natalie actually did it. So
was the tour as central to it in the first script that you got?
No, it was not in the script.
It wasn't in the script at all.
But that's when I got the script, and I'm like, what is this Chilean doing? And you know, in this story. And then Darren thought it was interesting to have somebody maybe that was not American who would have an approach towards her humanity more than the political circumstances. So I got the script, I read the story, and I go into the internet, and I just get into YouTube, and I found that incredible White House tour, and then I suggested to include it, and then Mickey Liddell came on board with Liddell Entertainment, and then Wild Bunch, and then now Fox Searchlight, and this like this incredible family who's pushing the film.
So how much of the film did it come together post versus how you shot it? I mean, was this film shot the way that you it ended up turning out to be?
Well, we had this, the script had a main structure, right, which is like the basic story from Dallas to the end of the funeral. Mm-hmm. And then we add another line that it was like the White House tour. And then there was another line, like a storyline and timeline, that was on the script as well that we developed more with Noah, that it was the interview, right? And then it was also the priest. Mm-hmm. So we had like four time layers, but we had no idea how we were going to cut the film. And we were just like, you know, in a harvest, just bringing stuff to the basket. And then basically then with Sebastian, we cut the film And I remember I was like, we were shooting and he already got the dailies and was like starting to make like first cuts on scenes and put them together. Mm-hmm. And I called him and said, what do you think? How are we gonna do this? It's so different from the White House to the journalist, the priest, and then the main sort of timeline. And he said, we'll be fine. We need just to find like the emotional bridges in between one scene and the other. And if we stick to her and just stay wherever she's feeling, then we'll find the movie. And that's what we did.
So is that scary or is that just basically how you do things?
No, that's how I do things. Yeah, I never know exactly how the movie's gonna be. And I think that's part of the process. I really enjoy it. And I don't think it's possible, at least for me. I know there's a lot of filmmakers who can do that, and I can't do that. Mm. I don't have a specific idea or an entirely complete idea how the movie will be. And so I just work kind of like creating and provoking accidents somehow. So what you do is like to build ideas and around a specific emotion and sensibility. Of course, you need a script. You need to have a very like clear structure and a dramatic arc that would always help and support the film, which is in both cases is the reality. But the way I work is that I face every scene as a unit and try to sort of find whatever the challenge of that specific scene is, and then just throw it to that computer where the movie is being cut, and kind of then discover exactly what the film will be. I just have a hunch on how it's gonna be, but I guess it all comes down to the character, what they're feeling, what they're going, and the mystery. I guess that's the key of cinema, that you could have a lot of information around the story, but it's very, ultimately, it's the audience that will complete what you're doing, because you could tell a lot of things, but I'm very worried that we don't say all of them, and we keep some of them for the audience to complete, so you get to have an active audience, and I think that's very beautiful.
So when you're in post, you have a moment where you go, aha, we figured it out. Now we know, now it's not a matter of putting it together.
Well, you have a lot of moments in post. You have a panic, and then where you're just like, oh, this is terrible, and you spend like weeks thinking that to just destroy a film. And then you like find a path, and then in this case, for example, we started getting music from Mika in the case of Jackie, and from other composers in the case of Neruda, and then you start putting them together, and then the film sort of start to have a specific tone and an atmosphere. That's what you're after. You know you're telling a story, and you need the elements to do that, and then those elements come from the script and of course from the incredible and super valuable work from the editors. But then what you are after is to find like a mood, a tone, which is what really grabs the audience and what stays with you. When you think about a film, whatever movie that you could talk about that you love and remember, you would do it because that would trigger a specific emotion in you, not just the story. It could be cool, it could be fun, it could be entertaining, it could be emotional, whatever, but you will remember that film because it would trigger a specific emotion in you, and that's what you work on, and to sort of to build an atmosphere. I do believe that tone in cinema and atmosphere are essential, and that's what I admire in other filmmakers, when I think about some specific filmmakers that I love and respect that really influenced me, I just keep thinking on something that is indescribable. Mm-hmm. It's like talking about music, you just can't.
So when you have Natalie doing this, does she do the work and then bring it to you and then you tweak it a little, or is there a lot of conversation about the detail of how she's gonna do it?
We did not rehearse at all. We just read together a couple of times. But it was mostly conversations, and then on the set, I would we would, work on shaping the shot and the intentions of the scene, And sometimes I would just like be very specific on what we were looking, or sometimes I would give her contradictory instructions. I would ask for something in one take and then something different in the other one, and she would like, what? And then she would do it, of course. And then we would just find places that we never thought there existed before. And that process is so beautiful. But Natalie's someone who has something that I think it's essential to cinema, which is, again, mystery, which is what probably what you could look and take from Jackie Kennedy. Mm-hmm. Jackie was someone that we and the entire planet knows or thinks that knows a lot about her. But the reality is that this is probably the most unknown of the known people ever. And Jackie was someone who had these stares and these eyes that they were so particular and so mysterious and beautiful. And I think Natalie has that. It has an enormous amount of mystery. She would have, of course, the style, the sophistication, the beauty, you know, that probably she could resemble Jackie very, very well. But that's not enough, I guess. Yeah. And what she really has that I guess very few people has, and in order to portray someone like Jackie, is the mystery that you really don't know what's going on inside of her.
So when you're going through takes and you're moving it her to one side, pushing the other way, and something, is the take that ends up being the great take, you know, the process of that, and it you finally get a take and you know that's kind of the thing has come together, or will you end up playing with all of those takes?
Yeah, you play with everything. Because what happens sometimes, like after sort of she got the character and we got how we were shooting it, and there was like a rhythm on the set that allowed us to shoot, I think, one third of this film in one take. Mm. There's a lot of in this movie and in Jackie that was just made with one single take. And then the second third, it was like, I don't know, two or three, and then the last third up to eight or whatever we needed. Mm-hmm. But yeah, she was like giving so much that sometimes I would feel that we didn't need to make more takes. And because you reach a point where she really got it and she had this incredible energy and we were like capturing it. That's why I think Stefan Fontaine's work is so important, not just in the lighting, but also with the camera work and like actually physically operating the camera. They were literally dancing, you know, and Natalie sort of had this this approach and this fragility that it felt always so interesting and beautiful. And so we were like very close to her. That's why this film has so many like extreme close-ups. And because I think the doors to this film are her eyes, and I wanted to be close to those eyes that would sort of contain this mystery we're talking about, but also this sort of combination in between beauty and sadness that is always very interesting.
And this massive supporting cast of a lot, there are a lot of celebrities in there playing kind of against type or playing in, you know, heavy makeup in ways that we don't really recognize them for a while. Was that just
the right people
coming along? Can you guys close the door? Oops, sorry.
Can you close the door, please? Can you
We're
close the door?
You guys.
Oh, sorry. We
have to wrap up. Emma. All right. We're almost there.
Well, yes, we had an incredible cast, I think. I think we're very lucky to have like someone like Greg Erwin, mm-hmm. Peter Sasker, John Hurt, you know, John Caroline. All those people is just amazing, and it's people that I admire for years. So yeah, and I remember talking with Peter that he had it was a big challenge for him because he was interpreting Bobby Kennedy, who's someone that he had admired all of his life. Mm-hmm. So it's very hard for him, just not as an actor, but as a human being, to be in those shoes. And I would like go and tell him, like, Peter, okay, man, I understand. I know it's hard for you. I respect it. I want to help. But I just want to tell you something. We're not doing just a movie about the Kennedys, and you're not just playing Bobby Kennedy. You're just a man. And just stick to that humanity, and it will work out. And he did it, and it's just so moving and deep what he does. And he's such an incredible actor. And then, like, John Hurt would just show up, and he would just, I don't know, just contain all this knowledge and sophistication and sort of in and like intelligence as well to sort of deal and support this woman. And Greta, that she's usually doing like other type of roles, and she came in and played Nancy, which was a very close friend of Jackie back then, and also her assistant. But they were like, they are friends, by the way, Natalie and Greta. So it really helped, because on the set you could feel that there's like a connection in between those two women, and it's something that you can't act at some point. I mean, you can, I guess, but it was so organic and natural among them. So it was incredible. And yeah, and there's also Mac Casella and a bunch of guys and the women that they just went and make it happen. And yeah, for me, I think I'm very lucky. I'm a lucky dude. That's for
and
sure.
And you get surprised. I mean, the movies came out in this very short period of time, Venice and Telluride and Toronto. Do you get surprised by the great response you got in all of that? I mean,
well, you don't expect it, because if you do, then you're too worried about it, and you're I don't know, doing your job because, you know, weird reasons. Mm. So we just focused on making the movie as pure and as emotional and as interesting as possible.
But when the raves come,
It's fantastic. It's wonderful, but then you take it easy as well, because it's great, but at the same time it's just a movie, you know. I mean, and I don't know. What I guess is great is that, and it's amazing, is that all these circumstances that they help you to talk about your work. And they help you and help the film to be more known, and thereafter more people get to see it, which is great. I don't want to keep the movie in the closet. I want people get to see it, and also at the same time, what you get to do as an artist is to share sensibility, and to expose people that at some point were in danger, and they worked and did such an incredible things for themselves and for others, in a very unexpected way, and when you're able to share that on a theater after a film, then you start feeling that you're doing something that means something, and that's always grateful.
It's been a remarkable, very quick rise for you, so I'm glad it's going well.
Please, come on.
Thanks so much for your time.
Appreciate it. Please, my pleasure.